So here I'm going to cover some basics in relation to police use of CS and PAVA. And this shouldn't be taken in isolation, you should also be considering it in relation to the national decision-making model, tactical options, the vulnerability assessment framework, subject profiling. Now, any use of CS or PAVA is a use of force, and you're looking there at that level. The CS and the PAVA are classed as firearms, so we're not talking minor threat in order to use the CS. But people often use the term CS and PAVA but don't actually know the difference between the two. So CS then, a CS canister should give 6 seconds of use compared to a PAVA canister which should give 10 seconds of use. Now CS has been used by police services since 1996 but was first discovered in 1928 by Carson and Stoughton, which is where the CS term comes from. Now CS is not a gas, it's a crystalline solid, but solvent is added to both CS and PAVA, which means then that the spray can actually end up being flammable. So the CS and the PAVA themselves are not flammable, but the solvents that are added to them can be flammable, and therefore they should not be used near ignition sources like flames. Now, if it's deemed necessary to use CS or PAVA, something else to consider is if it has no effect. For example, if the person is suffering from excited delirium or acute behaviour disorder or in a severe mental health crisis. It also increases the risk of positional asphyxiation, and there's medical implications must be considered throughout the use of any CS or PAVA, and constant observations applied to the person after CS or PAVA is used until they're deemed to be free of any after effects. Now, either CS or PAVA should be used from at least 3 feet away from the suspect. Any closer can cause eye injury, for example. The CS is not effective on dogs, whereas PAVA has a possibility of being effective on dogs. But with either CS or PAVA, there's a chance for creating burning sensation, the person being unable to breathe, panic, agitation, aggression. Therefore, it's not recommended that you use the sprays within crowds and groups of people. CS will contaminate an area far more than PAVA, and CS, even if it hits the person's clothes, will affect them. Whereas PAVA, for the effect, it's looking at actually hitting the eyes and getting into that person. It's not recommended that you use the sprays on a person who is physically armed or in close proximity to a firearm, because if they then can't see correctly, can't hear correctly and are disorientated and can grab a firearm, then it increases the risk to all of the persons nearby as well. PAVA, so I said that's got 10 seconds of use. That's been used by the police service since 2004, so you might find different forces have either predominantly CS or PAVA, or they've got a mixture of the two being used. And PAVA stands for pelargonic acid vinylylaminide, and it's a synthetic pepper spray. But again, it's got the solvent added to it in order to increase its ability to spray, which can make it flammable. And again, 3 to 10 feet is the ideal range for discharging PAVA. And you'll find that officers are trained to put their arm out and hold the PAVA towards their body. And this again is increasing speed so that you're not holding the PAVA or the CS out at arm's stretch, which then makes it closer to the person. In relation to aftercare, so once the officer has sprayed the person, then you're looking to try and create calm and reassurance of the person, because there's a good chance that they are going to go into panic. Give them access to fresh air and get them from the contaminated area. Constantly consider medical examination and also that the person might go into some kind of respiratory failure, particularly if there's other significant risks added to that. The person must be under constant supervision. So in there, we're talking about level 3 supervision observations. Contact lenses, when it's safe to do so, so particularly at custody, if the person's got contact lenses in, they should be removed, and copious amounts of water or saline fluid used to flush out the eyes, which should either be done by the detained person or the healthcare professional at custody. Now, for the custody staff, they should be constantly checking the welfare of the detained person until they're satisfied that all the effects of the CS or PAVA have gone. The CS, particularly on the clothing, can then contaminate the custody unit and affect other people, so the person needs to be separated and kept in a ventilated area as well. Something to think about, which is often not, is the drink drive procedure. Now, if somebody has been sprayed, then the recommendation is that it's 30 minutes between being exposed and going through the intoxilizer procedure, so that's 30 minutes. Also, that the clothing, if the clothing is contaminated, that could still be affecting the machine as well. So to have the person remove the contaminated clothes prior to the intoxilizer procedure as well is the recommended. Also, if the person's been sprayed with either CS or PAVA, they should be given the information sheet, which is specifically made for the detained person. And if the person then is juvenile or needing an appropriate adult for any other reason, the appropriate adult should also be given a copy of that. But certainly CS and PAVA, they are a use of force tactical option. Any use, even being brought out and threatened to be used, is a use of force, and there should be a use of force form completed in relation to the exposure of the CS or PAVA to a person. That use of force form then is disclosable, and it's all part of the national decision-making model, considering the intelligence and information that the officer is presented with, the threat and risks there, and that's also balancing the threat and risks to the officers, members of the public, and the detainee themselves, thinking then about your tactical options, and then the administration of the tactical option as well, and then whatever option is conducted, that the safeguards are in around that, constantly monitoring the person and thinking about the independent advisory panel for safer restraints. If it then proceeds into any additional restraint as well, that the person is at a higher risk of respiratory issues and positional asphyxia. So it's essential that the safety officer is deployed within the restraint technique, and that the person is constantly monitored, and their Dr. ABC for the responsiveness, airway, breathing, circulation is constantly checked throughout. Again, that's just a quick comparison between the two incapacitant sprays. Any questions, make contact. Subscribe to our channel, and then you'll get to hear more information videos. Thank you.